I'm making a smoothie, and it's going to be loud. I'm going to have to mute it. So I don't want to miss, and I won't be able to hear anything. But I'll have this done in, like, in like 1 minute.
Here's what I want from you, Keith, is if we're not going to start, then I want you to not mute it so that we can hear the blender. This is very okay. important to me.
It's going
to
be out. It's going to be very loud. Get ready.
Which one is the okay? It's up to the podcast crew to decide who's who, who's the blender.
Wow, Brett, that was a really good impression. Let's hear the blender now. Welcome everybody this week to the Damage Per Second podcast. It's week 36. I'm here with Brett and Keith. Introduce yourselves.
I am Brett. This is my introduction.
I'm Slick Jimothy. I don't have an introduction, but I'm going to try to do better. I'm new to the podcast. I'll have a brand new introduction for you guys next week, and I just really, I'm thank you for this chance.
Thanks for this opportunity. It means a lot.
No problem. I'm really just doing it as a favor to your parents, Jimothy.
I consider this an edutunity for me.
So it's week 36, and 36 is an important number because 36 is the number of minutes that I wasted looking up the literal definitions of dressings, different toppings, condiments after last week's podcast. So that was fun.
I'll have you know that there was a very heated discussion at the bar that I visit weekly about that. And when I was pitching it to them, I was saying the whole spiel, and they were like, "What the fuck are you talking about?" And they're like, "Well, I mean, ketchup is a sauce." Like, but what about when you put it on? And so then it was like a tangent for like 5 minutes. So it was a good thing to bring up.
And they got into it then after?
Yeah, no, they got into it. Yeah,
see, that's.
I didn't think that it was so important, the nomenclature. Boy, was I wrong.
And only the nomenclature.
That's it. Yeah, that's it. Nothing else matters.
Okay.
Sorry, wait a second. I thought you were a... I didn't realize you were a wizard. Do you have multiple characters in Diablo?
Yeah, so I started the wizard. You know what? So I'll talk about what I've been playing this week. So
yeah, go for that. So this isn't totally unrelated.
Right. So I'm playing Diablo still, and that's probably what... Like I was saying last week, I really like playing it on the podcast because it's very laid back. I don't have to focus as much. I might, go back and forth. Might go back and forth to StarCraft co-op every so often, but again, it's just... Diablo is so mindless. I don't have to focus on anything, and... This week I started a new character. I started a seasonal wizard for season 7. I have a barbarian who I just have, who's not seasonal at all. And so I've actually been focused on... They do these seasonal journeys where there's... So I guess let me start from the beginning. The way that the seasons work, if you're unfamiliar, is you basically have to start fresh. None of your artisans carry over. Like, you have to level them up. None of those carry over. You have no gold, no gear, nothing carries over your stash. It's just like as if you had just started the game, and that's how you start the season. And then every season is like maybe 3-4 months, maybe a little bit more. And the idea is you just challenge yourself to see how far you can get and how crazy you can get. And you're rewarded by completing what they call it a seasonal journey, which is like, okay, kill Diablo for the first time. And then that's just like round one. And then round two is get to level 70. And then round three is, it just gets like more and more complex, and you get gear mm-hmm. for it. So I've leveled my way. I've made it through the first four journeys, actually the first five journeys. And I've gotten the Tal Rasha set for the wizard, which is basically just like calls down a bunch of crazy meteors. And it's really
fun. I remember
fun.
That shit from Diablo 2. That's cool, like the callbacks and stuff.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I'm glad that it seems like they've really they understand that, like they've got to put more into it, like regular events. They got to put more into it than in previous games and stuff.
Oh yeah,
like Diablo 2.
Well, they have to keep it fresh, and I really think, I mean, this is the seventh season, and it's now turning to the point where it's like I see people on the subreddit saying like, unless something new is talked about at BlizzCon, I'm pretty sure this game has pretty much run its course. But it's, I mean, seven seasons, it's been a long time. I mean, it's interesting, though, because Diablo 2 was virtually timeless, and people who played Diablo 2 when it was in its prime could probably just keep playing it now. Whereas yeah. Diablo 3, it seems like it's just going to, you know, it'll run its course eventually unless they keep pumping out content or a new expansion or something.
It's weird. It's just because, like, I mean, it's just because it was better than every other game. The interesting thing is that it was basically as good as Diablo 3. I mean, not quite, but I mean, even comparing for its time, it was better. But even comparing them, you know, directly, it's nearly as good. And coming out when it did, I mean, there just weren't as many alternatives. So you'd just play that game for years.
Yeah. So I've made it up to Paragon level 237. And it goes really fast with the adventure mode. And like I keep saying it every week. I'm like, I'm surprised at how much fun I'm having with this game. Like, I didn't really expect to enjoy it as much as I've been enjoying it. It's just mindless fun. And I mean, that's, I don't really think there's anything else to really say about that. I mean, it's gotten to the point where, like, again, I started fresh, and this was between last week and this week. So it's only been 6 days at the most, because I didn't start on the day of the podcast last time. And so I've made it to level 70. I'm Paragon level 237. And it's gotten to the point where I do my daily bounties on Torment 7. And if it's not a legendary item or a gem, I just don't pick it up. I purposefully throw it away so that it doesn't take up space.
So what's the trick to leveling so fast? Is it just because it's a season? Is there like some sort of multiplier going on or something? Because I feel like my first playthrough took forever to get to 70.
Yeah, so 1 to 70 took me a while. I mean, it's really just if you don't play the campaign, like I just do these, they're called like daily bounties in adventure mode. And I didn't really understand adventure mode until I started messing around with it. But you can level a lot faster because it's basically just the whole world is open to you and Tyrael gives you 5 bounties on each map. And if you go and do all 5, you get extra gold for doing each one. And then you return to him and he gives you some boxes of gear and crafting materials. Like it's like special crafting materials you can't get anywhere else.
Huh.
And you get extra XP for that. So... And then eventually, like I was saying, with the way that the season works, you get gear sets. So I have this Tal Rasha set, and I can just blast through these bounties. Like, again, I'm on Torment 7, and I'm able to just blow through these really, really fast. And, you know, during the podcast, it's not going to be as super quick. But it's gotten to the point where, like, normally I would stop, and I'd meticulously kill everything and break all the stuff. And now I just run to the objective. And, like, I have passive abilities that will probably just kill most of the stuff along the way. And then I just get out of there. And maybe I'll die once because I get a little too greedy, but I'm not on hardcore or anything.
Yeah.
And it's just, I don't know, it's fun. And I like the idea of, I've gotten to the point now where I understand, like, where I want to farm to get better stuff. And I'm trying to get certain gear so then I can up to higher torment levels.
Yeah. Yeah, this character you've got now is looking pretty sick.
It's pretty neat. So I see myself probably playing this for another couple weeks until I get really sick of it.
What I really noticed is I was watching you play as was it Barbarian?
Yeah.
It just looked really satisfying. Like, I mean, I guess probably once you've done the same attacks over and over again, maybe it isn't as much, but like whatever. I mean, you had this big fire sword and you'd like smash the ground. These big waves of, you know, force would come out and just blast enemies apart, and it looked super satisfying.
Mm-hmm. It is. I mean, even this gear that I have now, I mean, I don't want to get into too much detail because it might be boring, but I mean, basically, it encourages you to use all the different element types. So I have my hotbar assigned so that I have like one fire spell, one lightning spell, one arcane spell, and I my right click is just teleport, and when I teleport it like blasts out a certain type of magic as well. So I just spam everything that's up all the time. And like every 8 seconds or something like that, like meteors just spawn out of the sky. That's the set bonus, and it just does a shit ton of damage to everything. So anybody who's watching, you'll see I'm just sort of running along. I'm not controlling when those meteors come down. It's just like, oh, my lightning armor hits something, so a meteor just comes down and hits it. Like it's just like it's crazy how they've scaled the gear so that you can just do enormous damage, just crazy damage.
Yeah, this is looking fun. I'm probably going to start another character here soon.
Yeah, and I mean, I can power level you really fast. Because again, like, if you were to join this game on Torment 7, you would get to level 70 really, really quick.
Join you and theoretically just follow you around and get all the experience?
Yeah, I mean, you could right now if you wanted to.
Cool.
So yeah, if you want to do that this week or any time, let me know. It's it would be fun to play with someone else. We could up the difficulty a little bit if I had more people.
Hmm. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, yo,
ye. The other thing I've been doing this week, thank you, Brett. Maybe I don't know if I really want to thank you for this, but I've been playing a mobile game called Egg Inc.
Hello.
And it's awesome. Basically Cookie Clicker.
That game is sick. I was actually listening to the Giant Bombcast, and Jeff Gerstmann was talking about the clicker games that he enjoys playing, and another one is like Adventure Capitalist.
I don't want to hear about it. No, I've heard of Adventure Capitalist. I've heard that's fun.
Man, isn't it so fun to watch those numbers go up in a stupid little game like making eggs?
I mean, you know what it is though? It's just satisfaction in its most basic form.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it doesn't need to be any more complex than that. You know, you skin, you know, you do the chickens and the eggs. It's like real, like a goofy skin of the same idea, the Cookie Clicker. And it's just, people say like, oh, that's dumb. And until you've tried it, it's just such a simple satisfaction. And it's the same satisfaction you'd get out of a lot of other games.
Like Diablo?
Maybe, well, okay, yeah, kind of like Diablo, except Diablo, you actually have to do stuff.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, but it's like at its most basic form, the reason that you're doing stuff in Diablo is because you want to see numbers go up in some fashion,
exactly.
Right? So it's kind of neat.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. It's a cool little game. And it's really not too disgusting with like the microtransaction stuff.
Oh, yeah.
I think I was telling Tara, like, you can get to a point with the golden eggs thing, because the way that it works is every time you buy an upgrade, you accumulate one golden egg for a piggy bank. And you can unlock that piggy bank for like $4 in real life, and you get all the golden eggs, which are used for like pretty good upgrades. And so, I mean, you'll get to a point eventually where your piggy bank is so full it's more expensive than like the highest tier that you can buy.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's like, why don't you just spend the $4?
Yeah, that's basically where I'm at. I haven't spent any money, and I don't know if I ever will. I mean, that's the thing about the piggy bank, though, is it scales, so that's kind of neat. Like, in terms of microtransactions, that's one of the more clever ways to do it, and it really feels, as a player, it really feels like it's not just a ripoff, because you can control what you're spending that money on directly based on how much you play. So yeah, the people that play the game more, who probably, you know, they're going to benefit more from it because just they're playing more. Mm-hmm. They're the ones that really, it's actually helping them. Like, if they really enjoy the game, then I can't really fault the company, because it's not really preying on them per se. Because at the same time, you can get golden eggs just by playing at a really reasonable rate. Like I
and
said, I haven't spent any money, and I've gotten a lot.
Yeah. Yeah, like watching ads and stuff, too, it gives you huge bonuses. So it's like, why not?
Yeah.
And
you're getting a huge bonus just thinking about it.
I also like it because you can play it offline. You can play it offline, so like when I'm underground on the train or something, you can play it on the train and things like that.
Mm.
And the other thing is, it just seems really smart. I'm sure a lot of other mobile games do this, but it seems really smart because they do this thing where it's like, oh, you want 48 golden eggs? Watch this 30-second ad. So you can watch, you know, a really short ad, and you just get really fast bonuses in game. So like I said, it doesn't feel disgusting with how they do the microtransactions. So
and
I think that's
and
pretty
I,
cool.
Honestly, I think it's a really cool looking game. Like, I love the shadow, like the lighting effects and the little chicken animations are pretty good.
Yeah, yeah, it's cute.
Definitely. Super cute.
Super cute. You know what? I'm not afraid to say that. People, I don't know, this whole thing, like, the stupid misspelling and shit. Like, oh, I'm going to spell LOL as L-E-L. Like, what? How would you describe that if not, like, some asshole just being cute? Like, that's what that is.
It's super cute.
Yeah. Like a smarmy cute piece of shit.
Damn, now you got me playing it since you talked about it. All right, I'm going to close it so I can focus.
The chicken thing? I mean, that's the thing. You can play that and you don't really have to focus on it at all. You just hold the button down and the chickens come out.
You'd be surprised.
What about you, Keith? No. Justin, what have you been doing?
I was
week?
Just about to ask if I could go next for what I've been playing.
You can't
go.
No, Justin, you know, now
next?
That you now that you ask, Brett, why don't you
go for it? Dude.
So, because I had things that were kind of related. So, number one, as far as like clicking games go, it's not a clicking game, but it's a mobile game that I've been. So I've been on vacation for the past week,
mm-hmm.
and. There's a game. Have you guys played Plague Inc.?
Oh yeah,
heard of it.
Tara likes that game a lot too.
What's the deal with that game?
So you're basically playing a. It was the most fun that I've had in a mobile game in a while, and I hate mobile games. So like the fact that I was playing this quite a bit.
Is it free or?
It's $1. So. Nice.
You know, there's like a full version of it on PC as well.
Oh, okay.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Sorry. So anyways. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. If you would like to continue. Fine.
So basically you play a disease and you could be a bacteria or a virus or all kinds of different sorts of diseases, or like bioweapon, things like that, and you try to infect the whole world and then kill the whole world. So
that's like real life.
Yeah. And it's pretty cool because it's a lot more complicated than you would think, because there are all these ways that you can increase infectivity. You get DNA that you spend on different upgrades, and there's different scenarios that go on, like Black Death. You kind of do that scenario and it has certain attributes that other diseases don't have, and or like you play Santa and you have to
Santa?
Infect the world. Yeah. Like the world's really sad and you have to infect the world and make them happier with this certain bug. And as you infect people, like they want the disease to infect more people, so they kinda help you out. But anyway, so you can make it more infectious in different ways, like this is better in cold climates, this is better in warm climates, this is this spreads through airports, this spreads through seaports, this spreads through livestock and birds and all kinds of different things. And you have to sort of balance it, because you need to infect and kill the entire world, but if you kill too fast, then you kill out everybody who's infectious and you don't end up being able to infect the whole world. And then there's like, if you kill off an entire landmass too soon or something like that, then it can be tricky because you can't infect other places. And so it was a lot of fun. There's a bunch of different scenarios and you unlock more as you go, and there's different difficulties and all kinds of stuff. So for $1, I got a lot of play out of it. It's also kind of, I feel like I learned a lot of geography. Because like, I'm terrible at geography, and there's like world map is the basic interface for it. So, and another thing, I should have mentioned, there's like lethality, and it's not just basic lethality. There's all kinds of stuff, like there's different symptoms that you can generate, and the symptoms affect whether or not people will become aware of the disease. So if it makes it more severe or something, like sneezing, people aren't going to be that aware of it, but there are all kinds of other things, and it can increase infectivity as well as increasing lethality. It can make, like, if it's a mental thing, it makes people paranoid and they're less likely to go out and seek treatment. So a lot of that stuff's, I don't know, pretty cool. So I played that some on my trip. And then once I got back, I've been playing some Overwatch. The new map, Eichenwald, is on the public test realm, as well as some of the new patches, the new patch. So I've been playing that a bit, sort of experimenting with it. Eichenwald seems really cool. It seems pretty difficult for the attackers. So that's, I think, the general consensus is that the defenders are sort of have the advantage on most of the current maps. So I guess people like that. And then what else? Anything else? I haven't played much Witcher this week. I'm gonna get back to it. And I don't know.
I kind of like the idea of how you describe that new map, where you're like, yeah, I mean, you're a pretty avid player. Like, you know a lot about the game, and you're just like, I guess people like that.
Yeah, that's what I was seeing online. See, maybe it's just that I'm like not high enough level, but I don't really think that attackers have a big advantage. So I was kind of like, yeah, whatever. But so I find the new one really hard. But if I'm attacking, which I have been like both times I've played it. And I think also the Olympic thing is over that they were doing. So I don't think you can unlock any of the Olympic stuff anymore.
Good.
Are those going to sell for a crap ton? Can they be sold?
No.
They can't be sold, unfortunately.
Okay, that's
I'm
good.
Sure they would. But oh, you know, I got one other thing. It's completely non-game related. But so I was on vacation this week, like I said, and I was I needed new flip-flops, and like my flip-flops worked totally fine, but I had them like super glued together. And but everybody who saw them, like a bunch of family was there, so everybody who saw them was like, "Oh, you're gonna get some new flip-flops? You think you've been wearing those flip-flops long enough?" And so I was like, finally, like, all right, fine. There's a million flip-flop stores around here because we're in, you know, we're in North Carolina. And yeah, it's just stores specifically devoted to flip-flops. So fine, I'll go get some new ones.
All those shitty beachfront stores, yeah.
And so we went and looked, and then I found some, and there was like a million. It was really overwhelming. There's too many. I just kind of wanted to get some. I was like, how different can they be? And then I got them, and I was like, yeah, these are okay, and I bought them. And before I left the store, I, like, put them on to wear them out. And then I, like, stopped. And, like, I turned around back to the clerk. And I was like, yeah, I got to be honest. I actually don't like these at all. Can I please return them? And I did. And then my dad was like, oh, you know, maybe you want to get some more? Like, we can look around. But everyone was, like, waiting on me. And I was like, no, I don't. I don't feel like I can make a decision right now. I need to leave. And so I left the store. And, and then, like, later, they were joking, like, hey, Keith, there's another flip-flop store. You want to go get some? And then I was like, all right, fine. I'm feeling more invigorated, like, less overwhelmed. Looks like there's a lower selection here, so I won't be as overwhelmed. There's a whole new clerk who doesn't know that I just bought and returned a pair of flip-flops in the span of 2 minutes. I feel good about this. So I was looking around. And the funny thing is that they didn't used to be like this, but all flip-flops have an arch built in now, like a lot of shoes do. And I have very flat feet. And all of them say, like, oh, you better get shoes with a big arch so that you can, you know, it'll improve your arch and it'll build it. It'll make your arch stronger and then you won't have flat feet anymore. Let me tell you, I've tried that. It doesn't work. I think that's just how some feet are shaped and people just make up that it's supposed to be good to have an arch. Because I've never had any problems except for when I have to wear shoes with an arch. And so, anyway, I spent all day looking for flip-flops. And I finally got a pair.
Proud of you. Right.
Flat and cheap. Nice.
Flat That's and awesome. Cheap. Just the way I like them.
Oh.
You know, speaking of new shoes, I bought new shoes recently. And I gotta say, it's kind of weird to me to think, like, how my feet adapt in a really bizarre way, because anytime I get new work shoes, they just destroy my feet. Like, I get bad blisters and just straight up cuts on parts of my feet. Oh. And I, for like the first 3 days, I'm thinking, like, all right, gotta just muscle through it. And then on day four, I just think, why am I still wearing these? These clearly are not ever gonna be comfortable ever. And then, like magic, they just stop hurting completely. And I don't understand how. I know people say, like, oh, your feet grow like extra skin in some areas, but like, I don't have calluses or anything. They just feel fine now. And I understand that the leather will start to shape around your feet, but the way that it goes from, like, absolute, like, I'm limping, like, I'm like, I'm walking in a really like a weird penguin fashion all the way from work back to my home, like a 15 to 20 minute walk down the road. I can barely walk. And then the next day I'm like, oh, okay, yeah, this is fine. I can make it.
Yeah,
just fine.
Actually fine now.
I don't understand it.
It is weird. And you see people say that a lot. They'll be like, hey, especially for nice shoes, they'll say, hey, just buy these shoes and they're going to be super uncomfortable and you're going to hate them for like 2 full weeks. Then they're going to be the best shoes ever. But it's interesting because, like, not all shoes are like that. Like, if you get normal shoes, they're just comfortable. And you're kind of like they're either fine or they're not. And you're like, why can't dress shoes just be made this way?
I just got my first pair of exercise shoes, actually. They're Asics. And man, those are like the most comfortable shoes I've ever had. And I've never bought shoes wide. I usually just let them sort of fan out on their own. And so all my shoes kind of have like a V shape now. But man, these shoes are so comfortable. And walking in them is a dream. It's like I'm wearing nothing.
Yeah, so do you have wide feet too?
Yeah, I do.
Same here. Are the A6 wide? Are the A6 that you got wide?
Yeah, they're like 2 years.
I've never done that either. Maybe I should do that.
Oh, you should, man. It really is a game changer.
I've thought about that.
I've never had a pair of shoes fit better.
The same thing happens where I just let my feet slowly destroy the shoe.
Yeah, exactly.
Until I guess it fits now, but the shoe is ruined.
Yeah, I have a pair of like high top shoes. They look ridiculous now.
Oh, so you got some workout shoes. So it sounds like you might be looking into working out. So as someone who's completely unqualified to do so, let me explain to you exactly the type of workout that you should be doing.
I've only been walking, actually. I've actually lost, like, I think 14 pounds, so.
I have people that do that
Ron,
to me.
It's not working. You got to do, you're going to want to do, I'm going to hook you up, bro. You're going to want to do, epic lifts 5x10, and you're going to want to get in there, and someone else has to hold your feet, and you put the barbell in your mouth.
Those types of people where, like, because I'm doing the same thing. I'm trying to lose some weight, so I've been dieting, and I just feel like it's like a constant barrage of other people who also need to lose weight and are not being very successful. Who are always like, oh, but you got to do this. You know, if you're just doing it like this, I hear, you know, you can't eat at night.
Do you feel like that? I feel like almost always the most, like, it's me, and I would never, like, say this to them, but I always feel like the most out of shape people want to tell you, like, all the stuff you got to do.
Yeah. Oh, man. I don't know.
It's all about, you just got to drink cranberry juice every day, and then your body will reject it, and all the fat will go with it.
Yeah, it's like some pseudoscience you would read in like a shitty magazine, you know?
Yeah,
that's hilarious.
You gotta wrap yourself in cellophane, and you sweat.
Brett, what have you been playing this week?
Well, I'm playing Diablo right now. I was waiting on that invite, but I didn't get one.
Are you really?
If you can, I mean.
Yeah.
Nah, but really, what I've been playing, so I picked up the new Ratchet & Clank game. I mean, it's not new anymore, but it's like a reboot of the original game, and it's also a tie-in with the Ratchet & Clank movie, which is not supposed to be very good. But I'm actually really enjoying that game. I never played the Ratchet & Clank series as a kid, and I never really played platformers like that in general, and so it's kind of nice to play something that's just sort of light and fun, and it's got a lot of fun little guns. Like, you can you get a gun that, like, shoots out big pulses in an area of effect, and, like, just goofy. It's just really goofy and lighthearted, and you play as a young anthropomorphic thing that probably inspired many furries today to become who they are. It's weird, that game is super self-aware, because it in the beginning of the game you're watching a cutscene of the, I can't think of his name, Captain something, there's like this
Captain Quark.
Yeah, Captain Quark, and he's like talking about how the game is, it, well, somebody comes in and says that he got the new game that's like the reboot of the movie thing, the blah blah blah, and so over the course of the game he's telling the story of the original Ratchet and Clank as you're playing it. And so there's a lot of funny interactions with that. Like, oh, he tried to jump over the thing and failed as you die or something. So it's kind of neat. And it's been really fun. It's a good first experience in the game. Oh, hey, you're in here. What's up?
I am. What you're going to want to do is quit out, go to the adventure mode, and set it to the highest difficulty that's available to you.
Cool. Outside of that, I also picked up The Sims 4 on sale, and that game is funny as hell. And it's another series I never really paid attention to, but now I am a little bit. It's pretty fun. I don't think it's changed much since the older games, but it's been an adventure, to say the least.
Are you still playing a lot of Street Fighter?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, oh, actually, I guess short story. I tried to go to my first tournament. I was going to enter my first tournament last week at the Game Underground in Natick, Massachusetts. And I couldn't because I got there after my hour and 15-minute drive, and they said that there was going to be no tournament because there wasn't enough people there. And so I was like, well, that kind of sucks, because I brought my friend with me too. So this is right near where he went to school, so instead we just like went to a bar and then went and visited some people at his school, which he graduated from already. So it was really nice, actually. It ended up being a fun night. I played one match against the guy who was there, and I won one set out of like four. So I felt good about it, you know. I was a little bummed that we made that long drive. So I'm going to try to go this Friday. Hopefully I'll be able to report back that I won my $10 back from entering, but that's probably unlikely.
Honestly, winning one out of four, I would be happy with that. I feel like I would just get so nervous playing in public.
Yeah, I was really happy with it. It was really cool. It's so much better than playing online to play somebody right next to you, like, because you can ask them questions if you need to. You know, there's no lag, like, at all, which is incredible. Because playing fighting games online is really, it's shaky, you know. You just never know what you're going to get. I've been getting really frustrated with that game in the past couple days because I keep accepting competitors who have, like, a 5-bar connection, and then it's laggy. And it is just infuriating. So, I don't know. I'm still loving it, though. Waiting on that new character, Yurian, to release.
And, hey, Justin, should I create a seasonal hero?
Yeah, dog.
Okay, I'll do that.
Do it.
I don't know who I should play.
Whoever you want. We're going to level you up real quick.
All right.
So, one thing that you guys had talked about that you had brought up in this stream, not in the stream, in our chat before, was that PS Plus prices are going up. And yeah. I was actually talking to Tara about this earlier, and she was asking, like, so what exactly is PS Plus? And I'll be honest, I'm not a Sony user. I imagine it's so that you can use their servers for multiplayer and specific games. But can you explain what the service is and your thoughts on the price going up?
Well, it's funny because apparently a lot of the games that are on PSN aren't even using Sony's servers. So really, what's the reason to pay for PS Plus if you're playing multiplayer?
Yeah.
But so every month they do the monthly picks for games that you get to download for free, and Xbox Live has adopted that as well. And you get to play online with your friends, and that's about it. And Sony's PSN service is pretty bad, to say the least, I think. I think the download speeds are atrocious, and I've never really played the multiplayer at all. Oh, I guess I played Street Fighter Online, but now that I have on PC, I'm not using PSN at all. So the price increase is not good to me. And their pickings for games, for free games, has been pretty garbage for the past, like, 8 months, too. So I don't think I've booted up a PS Plus game in a long time.
Yeah.
I don't know how you feel about that, Keith.
It's kind of the issue is that quality has been decreasing and the price has been increasing, so I'm not really sure what the justification is for that, or if they really felt the need to give a justification for it. But, you know, it's just one, it's just another sign that, like, there's not really any sense being a, you know, PlayStation or Xbox fanboy. You know, the favor will swing in one direction or the other, and then everybody will be like, yeah, Sony's awesome, like, you know, we won, our console won. And then, you know, once they don't have to compete as much anymore, then the prices for PS Plus go up and they stop paying to get, like, AAA or even really AA games for free monthly. They're like, oh, now PS Plus, you need it to play online. But don't worry, because even though it's basically required now, we're not going to stop giving you, you know, good free games or anything like that. And then, of course, they do. You know, meanwhile, Xbox has been doing great. As far as I know, last time I checked, their monthly service, you know, they have a lot of really good AAA games that they were putting in with games with gold. So, you know, that's just a reminder to everybody that competition is good. And it's... generally good. I mean, you see like console exclusives and stuff like that, but that's, you know, a whole other conversation. Mm-hmm. But in general, yeah, you want them both to be around, because then they kind of have to compete with each other and offer good features and not. And you know, $10 more a year isn't huge.
That's huge.
That's huge.
I think that Xbox Live Gold has been $60 a year for a while now.
Yeah.
But it might have been before they were doing the free game stuff. And actually, their servings have been pretty good recently, too. So, I don't know. Like, when it first started, it was nothing in comparison. They were, like, giving just complete shit. But now it's actually improving. Now that the Xbox One's library is expanding and the backwards compatibility as well. Because, like, half of the servings for PS4 or for Sony are PS3 games, which you can't play on your PS4. And if you're like me, and I sold my PS3 when I got my PS4, which is just, I don't know, I just do that.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's just, I don't know.
So, one thing, you know, talking about streaming services, so Netflix is a great example where people have been pointing out that Netflix's library has actually gotten progressively smaller. And I think it's a lot of things people don't realize, because it's just a big trend to streaming digital. You know, a lot of cord cutters, quote unquote, whatever. And I think it's just, you know, it's part of, it's just part of the cultural thing to do when you move into a new apartment. You know, you retain your Netflix account, or you set up your internet, and you get a Netflix account if you don't have one. And that's just something people do now. So, like, you get your first apartment or you get your first credit card, and the first things you do, you know, you set up electricity, you set up cable, and or not cable, you set up internet, and then you have Netflix. And that's just how you get started, I suppose. And I think Netflix and streaming services in general are realizing, like, there's competition, but this market is just huge and constantly growing. So maybe they're just, I mean, I don't want, Netflix is great. They have some really good content, but I think maybe PS Plus is a good example. And Netflix too, where they realize, like, we only need some really good content. We don't have to do that much else. Like, we're just going to provide, like, not the bare minimum, but it seems like it's slowly going that way. Because that's kind of how internet providers work these days. You just kind of do the bare minimum, and
yeah,
and that's it. I mean, and I'm concerned.
Netflix is the clear winner in that sector, and I mean, by a large margin. You know, there's other services like Amazon Prime Instant and Instant Video and, you know, Hulu Plus and these other things, but they don't even come close to Netflix. And I don't know if it's that everybody has already watched everything and that they want to watch these long shows. So if they remove Avatar The Last Airbender, if they remove, you know, whatever, people aren't going to care. Or if they just realize, like, it doesn't matter if we remove these things. People aren't leaving the service.
Yeah, exactly.
And if people try to, you know, negotiate up with us, I know part of it is that people realize that, I mean, these companies, these production studios, TV studios are realizing, oh, this is a huge market. We can probably ask for some more money. And so I know that's probably part of it, but I don't know. It is interesting where you see, like, prices going up and the selection going down, and you kind of wonder about Netflix. Some of these companies are, like, beloved by everybody.
Yep.
And then stuff comes out, like, they say, oh, Comcast net neutrality, they're slowing it. And then it came out that Netflix was throttling its own customers.
Oh, really? I didn't know about that.
I don't remember what their justification was, but they admitted that they were, like, accusing Comcast of doing it, and then it turned out that they were doing it.
Ugh.
And I don't remember if it was, like, a device thing, like, oh, well, people were doing it on mobile, so we throttled it deliberately because we didn't want to use up people's data. I think that was, like, the excuse. But I don't know. It's just, is always a reminder that, like, no matter how much you like a company, it's always good for them to have competition, because at the end of the day, they'll try to make money in any way they can if they think they can.
Yep. Well, and the first people in will always generally have the biggest. The first competent people in will generally be off in the best situation. So, like, I think Netflix is a great example. There definitely were some streaming services before them, but they really made it exceptional, I think. And yeah. So they're always going to be beloved by fans. And it's interesting, like you say, like, people just love that. Like, people love Valve, people love them. And every so often they do something that's kind of questionable, and then people forget about it really fast. Whereas yeah. Comcast, I don't know what they could honestly do to change their image, but they could do something great this year, and I just feel like it would never change their image. I don't know what they could do that would legitimately change their image.
Yeah,
at this
I'm
point.
Wondering. Yeah. Like, I'd love them to try, because that's the other thing, is I don't think that they really try.
Yeah.
But I don't know if they could change their image at this point. I'm, like, trying to think of examples where people did a whole 180 on something, and the one that I can really think of is the, like, Tom Wheeler from the FCC, who was originally, like, he was previously a lobbyist for the cable companies, I think, and then he started making decisions that were kind of in the cable company's favor, and then I don't know what happened, but all of a sudden he just did a total 180, and he was like, you know what, let's fuck these cable companies. We're gonna regulate the hell out of them.
Yeah,
out of nowhere. Maybe he realized that, like, he didn't really owe them anything anymore, and now, you know. But that's the only real example, like, in that kind of area where I can think of people doing a total 180 on from, like, a PR perspective.
Yeah, yeah. My concern is that, so for something like, I think, PS Plus and, well, okay, so it has an Xbox, like, you have access to their service, but you just pay if you want the really good one. Is that basically how that is?
I don't even know if they offer, like, they used to call it Xbox Silver, and basically, yeah, you have some online options, you know, you can use the services like actually, I won't say that, because I'm not sure if you can use, like, Netflix and stuff without gold, because I think the case was that you used to not be able to. I'm not sure what it's like these days. But you can do basic online stuff without paying for it, you know, you can make a gamer tag and whatever. But the thing with Xbox is that most Xbox games are run on Xbox servers, and the multiplayer experience is really, really reliable and good.
Yeah, yeah.
So when you have the case of PSN running off of, you know, independent companies' servers, it can really kind of be shitty sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one good part of Xbox Live.
Yeah. So there's some consistency there, some reliability.
I mean, I was at a buddy's house for UFC 202 or something, and we were just briefly talking about, like, oh, Xbox. I was, like, joking around, like, dude, PlayStation's, like, way better than Xbox. I love my PlayStation. Dude, Xbox sucks. I'm just realizing, like, they're just, like, the same exact thing now. Like, there's literally no rivalry at all. They're even, like, thinking about doing crossplay between the two on certain games.
Yeah.
You know, what's the difference? And I don't know if I would pay for two different console services when one difference between them is that one has a slightly better internet service than the other. Like, at this point, I'm using my Xbox for Netflix and Twitch and all that when I'm you know, like, trying to fall asleep or something, over the PlayStation for basically no reason.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's the same thing.
Know. Yeah.
Well, and Keith, you bring up a good point about competition. Is, like, it hits a point where, again, the service, like, these services, they kind of collect, they're not really colluding, but they collectively realize, like, people are probably going to get these no matter what.
Yep.
So, like, what can we do to not, again, not directly collude, but basically say, like, I'm pretty sure that, okay, we're Sony, and, you know, what do we think that we can do that's pretty much bare minimum such that we don't get undercut? And yep. I think that's kind of where we're heading right now, unfortunately, because, like,
you're seeing
shit.
Like, I didn't realize that Xbox had been at $60 for a year. Like, what shouldn't happen is one company is like, hey, wait a second, the other company's charging $60. We're only charging $50. Let's raise our prices. You
yeah.
know what I mean?
I think
we're the same as them.
I think the wording was, like, in the current console ecosystem or some shit like that. So basically it meant, like, well, we can do this, so we're going to.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I guess, you know, they've sold their consoles. It doesn't really matter to them. So now they can just jack up the price for no reason.
Yeah.
So, I don't know, I'm not really, I mean, it's like I'm not super pleased, but I would not feel I wouldn't feel too bad about just never not resubscribing immediately for PlayStation Plus, because I haven't really had my worth in a while. So,
do you think those subscription services make it such that, and maybe this is kind of what they're trying, where it's like, well, we're going to raise the prices and we're not going to have, we're probably not going to have as much content. How about we just see who stays? Like, they must have done some sort of research to think like, oh yeah, they'll stay. Cause like Netflix, they keep raising the prices a little bit. The library is shrinking, but I mean, I have not ever even considered canceling my Netflix subscription. And I wonder if PS Plus is going to try to make that same gamble, but I really don't view them as comparable.
Yeah, because it shouldn't be, you know, it shouldn't be like, oh, what's the maximum our customers are willing to pay? It should be, hey, what is the comparable competitor charging? Let's match it. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, there's a reason.
It's undercut them.
There's a good reason for why when you go and buy a PlayStation Plus subscription in store with a card and you put the code into your thing, there's a good reason that it auto renews automatically after a year. It's because they want to keep you no matter how deceiving they're going to be about it. And then maybe that's thinking a little too like conspiracy about it, but I don't know. That just really, that whole thing frustrates me. And I think they'll do whatever they can to keep their customers, even when they're raising the price. Like, I don't know. Maybe they're accounting for, I'm sure that they've accounted, you know, hey, maybe we'll lose 3% of our current subscribers for PlayStation Plus, but at $10 more for each of our current subscribers, it's worth it. So fuck it.
Yeah. I wonder if we'll get some benefits because we've got these sort of secondary consoles coming out, like the Slims and stuff, and they're going to be trying to attract their customer base again. So maybe we'll see some goodwill like we saw. I mean, there was a lot of that when the consoles, you know, this generation of consoles first came out. So we'll see.
I don't know. Is it sad to think, like, I don't expect that at all? I don't know. Maybe I should.
I don't know. Who knows?
I don't know. Maybe not for the Slims.
Not for those Slims.
That leaked PS4 Slim looks horrible, by the way.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I don't know if it's real or fake or what. It certainly looks real, and there's like an unboxing video of it, but I feel like it wouldn't be too hard to just take the insides of a PS4 and put them in some shitty shell. So
yeah, it wouldn't be too hard.
We'll see.
It looks like they just...
There's a big announcement soon, I think.
Rounded the corners or something, and... I don't know what
it doesn't look too much smaller.
Oh, can we talk about Pokemon Go?
No.
Are you bitter about it?
No. Nah, I mean,
I thought you seemed like you don't want to talk about it.
What's there to say, you know? A lot of people aren't playing it anymore.
Yeah. I think they've lost.
We kind of pictured this, right? Like,
yeah, we saw that coming. It's just like, I don't know. It was just like, obviously, like, they had a lot of goodwill from the start just because of their subject matter. Mm. And we're like, wow, there's really, like, they did the bare minimum for this game, and they can't get new stuff out fast enough to capitalize on it, to capitalize on their early, you know, the people who jumped in early. And what they had, which was the bare minimum, got boring. So it's unfortunate. I mean, I hope that...
Well, I mean, then they got rid of that tracking thing, which apparently didn't even work. But still, that was kind of the big part of it, right?
Like, yeah.
Being able to find Pokemon.
Yeah.
And whatever.
Like, that's a big part, too. Like, that's the thing. It's like, I don't know. It's just shitty.
They haven't handled the post-release very well at all.
Yeah, they are removing features rather than adding them. Like, when you put out the bare minimum and you talk about all these great, you know, I keep saying that, and you talk about all these great features that you're going to come out, all these great features we have planned, and then the updates come around and you remove features, and then when they explain why, they say, oh, it's so, I mean, we had to, you know, reduce strain on our servers so that we could do our Brazil release. And you're like, well, so you're just, I mean, you're going for breadth and not depth, basically.
Oh, yeah.
And, yeah. I mean, I don't know if I can blame you guys because you've been so successful, but yes, I can, because now, you know, a ton of, like, 10 million people have stopped playing your game. That's what happens.
Yep.
Well, again, we talked about this, and you know, I don't want to talk about No Man's Sky any more than we already have, but it's just this early release attitude, and I think
finish your game.
Yeah, there's a bad precedent set now with early releases, because like, people have shown they're willing to pay for it, and now that's all we're going to get. You're never going to get all your features on launch. You just aren't anymore for, like, especially a highly anticipated game. It's just don't get it. Just really, really unfortunate, I think.
Yeah. It's just, like, and they're like, well, you know, asking people to understand. They're like, well, we got to get it out to Brazil, you know? We got to get it in their hands. Like, they don't even get to play at all, stuff like that. And you're like, this is a manufactured problem. It's because you guys put it out too early.
Yeah, yeah.
You guys don't have the server space. And, I mean, or you guys didn't load test enough. Or any of a number of things. That game didn't need to come out this year, let alone, you know...
Yeah, I'm not sure if they not expect the feedback, like I'm sure they didn't expect it to be as wildly successful as it was, but I'm surprised that they couldn't have delayed it for an extra 2 to 3 months. There must have obviously been some major pressure there, some investment.
Certainly it was outrageously successful, but there's not really any excuse for not having enough servers when you're raking in money like that.
Right.
You know, you can use AWS or Amazon Web Services, or you can use, you know, Google App Engine. There's several services out there that you can run your servers on that just dynamically, they say, okay, yeah, more people are trying to connect, so we'll add some more servers on. People never need to not be able to log into your app because you don't have enough servers. That never needs to happen.
Yeah.
And, you know, let's say it's a free app and they're not raking in any money. Then, okay, well, I understand they can't just afford to dynamically spin up these new servers. But they were making a ton of money. There's evidence that they were making an absolute shit ton. So, I don't know.
Unbelievable.
We don't have servers is not really an excuse.
I'd like to see that game improve. It was a lot of fun for the time that I spent with it.
So they're talking about adding a few things. Well, not really. Honestly, not. They're talking about adding really minor stuff. They're talking about adding, like, oh, well, you'll be able to talk to a trainer, and he'll tell you about your Pokemon's powers, so you'll know which ones are better at battling.
And we just, what?
Yeah, it's like, okay, anything that you could put in some patch notes to show to investors that, oh, we're actually going to do something and retain some of the people so that, you know, they stop running away at this point.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, it's still at its core, if people were playing it, it was a flash in the pan, which is exactly why I think why it burned out so fast. Like, it was a one-hit wonder because there was no longevity to it. And if people played it too much, like, it was too cool. So people played it so much that they just stopped playing really fast. It's kind of unbelievable, I think. Yeah.
I mean, that happens. Fads are a thing.
Oh, yeah.
And whatever, I mean, I hope someone uses their concepts to do something
way better.
Like, it's depressing when someone has great, you know, subject matter and a great idea, and then they half-ass it. And I guess, you know, whatever the next thing will be, it'll probably be cool, but it probably won't be Pokemon.
Yeah.
Yep.
Meow. Meow, meow, meow. Let's talk anecdote tonight, because I don't have one.
oh, shit, yeah. I don't either.
All right, tell us about a time when you were buying flip-flops, and you have an interesting story about it.
I ain't got that.
Not really.
Well, you already did that, so that's not fair.
Oh, no, I guess you're right. Yeah, no, that's a good...
oh, yeah.
Okay, talk about a time... That.
Do you guys like your sandwiches cut diagonally or down the middle?
I like diagonal just because of the vanity of it.
Yeah,
it's unique.
It's like a faux pas.
It's nice. You didn't see that coming, did you?
Most people, I think, do down the middle. So I think that.
Yeah, and I don't really. So my friend, this was another bar discussion connected to the condiment one. And my friend thinks that down the middle is the absolute way to go. No other way.
Really?
Because of the symmetry of the crust. And he also thinks that the soft part of the crust is the worst part of the crust, and that the like harder part.
Oh my god!
I know.
Oh my god! What?
Exactly.
Ew.
So the reason I like a cross is, for one, it makes me feel like a kid again, and everybody wants that. All right. I mean, come on.
Nice. Like a peanut butter and jelly sliced diagonally.
Oh yeah. Perfect.
I mean, that's how my mom used to do it, and she's since passed away, so it really reminds me of the good old days.
Oh, jeez.
Well, the way you said that, you're like, yeah, it makes me, you know, who doesn't want to feel like a kid again? I'm like, well, I can think of a few reasons why I don't need to feel like a kid again, but.
Okay, yeah. Beside the point, I like it because the angle at which you get to put it in your mouth, you know, it's like, it goes in nice and easy. That sounds weird. So, but
I thought you were saying that on purpose because it was fucking weird.
It's got a better angle for good biteage.
I definitely prefer it sliced diagonally, and I'm trying to think of a legit reason why.
I know. It's like.
It's too skinny when you cut it down the middle. I don't know.
It makes the sandwich feel a little bigger when it's cut across.
It does.
So I've been thinking.
There's more surface area for biting. Because it's the hypotenuse rather than just the length or the width.
Yeah.
About that. See, I wish I had like a good reason. I don't have any good real reason at all. I just think that diagonal is cooler.
Yeah.
That's it. That's all I got for that. I think it's cooler.
You want to be cool, get a diagonal.
Get
if
the
you
diagonal
be a baby,
cut, yeah.
Get down the middle.
Alternatively, I've been recently getting more into wraps. And I used to think, like, oh, wraps, who wants a wrap? Like, that's just for people trying to lose weight. And I am, so I started eating wraps. And I gotta say, I think I like them better.
Wow. Like, what kind of wrap are we talking? I'm not talking, like innards. I want, like, what kind of, like, wrap are you using?
Like a wheat wrap or a spinach wrap. Now, I used to think my expectation was that the wraps would be too dry. And that was my fear. I didn't want to be eating no dry wraps, all right?
That's not the case.
Yeah, so luckily... it's usually not the case. I mean, the wraps that I get, they've got some moisture to them. And again, it's not what I would expect. In fact, regular bread, generally to me, is way drier than a wrap,
yeah.
Which is why now I prefer the wrap. And it's less calories.
Look at that.
It's a pretty good choice. Yeah.
Good spinach wrap.
Sometimes
yeah, that's nice.
I have had like bread-heavy sandwiches. You go to other countries, too. And I don't know if I've talked about this before. If you go to other countries and you order a sandwich there... Sometimes it's just bullshit. Like, it's like a huge piece of bread. Like, they love their bread in other countries. And then it's like a little sliver of prosciutto. Like, someone...
I hate that.
...rubbed their thumb on a piece of meat and then smeared it on the bread. And it's like, it's imperceptible. Like, not only is it imperceptible, but it is extremely dry. I feel like American sandwiches are just objectively better.
I don't know about the American thingy. I think it's more the idea that yeah, sometimes they just use too much bread and then it's dry bread. The worst is when I feel like I'm getting cuts in my mouth because I'm like chomping into ciabatta bread that's like really hard and crusty, and it's like is this like fucking sourdough? And I get like cuts
like
inside
hurts.
My mouth. And
like
I don't know if that's
so. If it's like sourdough and it's so, I don't know what the term is like. You have to tear at it with your teeth. It's so hard.
Yeah.
The whole sandwich falls apart.
If I was just eating the bread as like an appetizer, then that would be okay. But when I'm trying to bite through the bread, and because it's a sandwich, you can only really go at it from a specific angle, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So my concern is that you just can't get at it the way that you'd want to. And then it just feels like the corners of the bread, like the little edges, they like give me little tears inside my mouth. It's the worst.
Mm-hmm.
I just think this is not what I wanted at all for lunch.
I think I'm getting on board with the whole wrap idea.
Mm-hmm. They're way better. I don't know. I never would have expected that. I never used to eat wraps, and now I'm totally into wraps. They're great.
That's good to hear.
Do you think you'd describe yourself as a rapist? You're pretty into raps.
Oh, yeah, that's exactly it. What a time to be alive. I have a lot to say about sandwiches. I suppose this isn't the time, but that's a good idea for an anecdote for next week. We can talk a lot more about sandwiches.
Oh, yeah.
Really excited about it.
I love sandwiches. It's probably my favorite kind of food. I don't even give a shit what's inside it.
I like to call them Sambos.
I had some delicious pulled pork for dinner and some grilled buns. Delicious.
Okay, so do you put the pulled pork on the buns, or do you just eat the pulled pork?
I put it on the buns. Why wouldn't I do that?
I don't know. I guess I've always been sort of partial to just eating the pulled pork.
That's just weird, I guess.
No, see, look, I wasn't putting you down, Brett.
All right, I wasn't putting you down.
I was just saying.
I guess I'm putting away from this.
I guess what to say is I'm putting you down.
Yeah, you're like, man, Justin, you're a fucking idiot. Even though you were saying that how I enjoy the pulled pork is fine and normal, and you just want to share something cool, but no. I guess we can't be friends.
Share something cool.
That's exactly what I said, word for word.
It was. Everybody in the chat heard it, and so did Keith.
I heard it. Guys, I'm desperate to come clean about something.
Okay.
When I said that I like to call them Sambos, what I should have said was that Jen liked to call them Sambos, and then I took it.
You took it!
Now I do it. That was her idea.
For a second, I thought you were just going to say, I actually just don't. I made that up right now.
I don't do it.
It's a blatant lie.
I'm not going to start now.
Cool. Well, what a fun time to be alive. And I look forward to talking to everybody next week, where we're going to have more exciting game topics and possibly sandals, sandal buying stories.
They're flip-flops.
My parents call me the flip-flop flip-flopper now.
Ah, really? Because that's awesome. That's a perfect name.
You do.
That's good.
They did do that.
Cool.
It was really upsetting to me.
Every time they say it, it really hits me deep.
It cuts deep.
Thanks, everybody, for joining us. This is the DPS Podcast. We're the DPS Podcast, signing off.
Yeah.